I told you, don't forget about the plan. Don't forget about our mission.
I'm working 35 years with De Kuyper, family owned distillery, starting in 1695. We started with making Geneva. In short, if you want to make a spirit or a liqueur, you need flavors. There it starts all. You can produce flavors with a distillation process or with extraction. This pot still enables us to produce flavors. This profession was found out 1,000 years ago and it's still used in the distilling industry. This is a real old one. This is the basic one, but it's still used, for instance, in the whiskey industry and the rum industry, because with a pot still you can make very flavorish distillate. First of all, we use this pot still. What we do is we take alcohol and the basic material of which we want to have the flavor. Then we distill, we heat the pot still, and the alcohol will evaporate together with the flavor in the alcohol. It will evaporate, and by the condensation of the liquid, there will be alcohol enriched with the flavors we develop in the United States, also very nice products. And in 1984, my colleague in the States developed Peachtree. It was the greatest success ever in history. They produced 1 million cartons in 10 months.
So the drink I made is one of the most simple recipes, but also the most tricky recipes. This is a drink that I shake the drink, you can also stir it in the glass. That's what they normally did back in the days. So with the old style of the Geneva, with lemon juice, a little bit of sugar, added some sparkling water. I normally use the soda water, so it's very, it has a lot of carbonation. So it's very strong, it's very dry. So this is what we call a Geneva Collins. So Matthijs, you can have the first sip.
Okay, thank you.
You like it?
It's great, yes. Thank you. It's world famous of its flavor. It's a strong cherry, a very flavorish product. I have the extract.
But when I started making drinks, people were like, wow, this is a good drink. And they were coming back, and the guests became friends. So this is what I like to do. But when we look at the bar, you always have to make a proper drink, a good drink. That's what you do as a bar, you make good drinks. The only difference is, when you make a good drink, you can make it even better with your own personal flair, with your smile, with your conversation. You know, you interact with the guests, and that's the most important thing that that I would like to see. So we start with the base. You're gonna love this drink, but it's a bit strong because it only has alcohol and a little bit of dilution and some bitters. What's very important in this drink is also the garnish. I like to use, in this case, because it has a lot of sweet flavor, so I like to use some sour, some citrus flavors. So I'm gonna use the zest of lemon and just spray the oils on top of the drink and coat the glass like this. And what you can do is you can also coat the entire glass, because that's the extra thing that you give to the drink with this garnish. When you serve the drink, you get the drink, let's say I'm the guest, I'm gonna drink it, put it back, talk to my friends, and wow, I smell the oils of the lemon. So this is what we call a cherry, no, this is what we call cherry, your old fashioned. Oh, you wanna taste, sorry, yes. The boss always has to. Yeah? This drink is called the Snow Fairy, in this case from Finland. There you go. So with these types of tequila, the 100% agave, I think they're so terrific that it's up to you. I don't say that it's good or bad, or everybody has their own taste, but I don't use salt anymore in my margaritas. The rosemary margarita, simple and very different than you might be used to. Bit of oils on top of the drink. Drop it in. Amaretto sour.
It's a mess. Everything's everywhere. Look at the sink. It's my thing. This is a very beautiful bar. Yeah, we can all agree on that. One of the most beautiful bars I've been stood behind. But practically speaking, it's shit. Alright? Because the sink is back there. You have nowhere to clean your glasses. You have absolutely no space. Okay, we filled most of it. It's still adding. But, you know, the way a bar works translates into how fast you are as a bartender, and that translates into how good you can be. All right? This is the most important part of our work. You know? You see the ice melt. Right? So you want to have a nice ice chest where the water can drain away. Your ice will stay fresh. Same thing goes for a sink. You need a good sink. Preferably somewhere near, so you don't have to move all around. See, if there was two of us standing back here, the one standing here would have to go around the other person, especially if you have a large colleague like me.
People are talking about like how to distill drinks, how to make cocktails, how to keep it tidy.
Yeah.
But like, it's good also to have fun.
As long as it's clean.
No, but
you only have fun, you don't clean it. No. I've never seen you clean it.
Yeah, you never saw me walking anyway, so you don't know. What I'm saying is like, this, if you go that clean, then I'm perfect to walk behind your bar.
No, but this isn't clean, this is his fault.
Okay, for me I think fun side is very important. So can I use your clean bar to...
No, yes, you can't.
Why not? Flaring is the art of making the drink while entertaining people at the same time. Okay? Using everything and only anything that belongs to the bar. But flaring is your personality. When I say you can use anything to entertain the people behind the bar, it's going to be your personality, your style. It's the difference between juggling and the flaring. Because when you walk behind the bar, to look good, flaring, you don't need to do much. You just go like this, bar, you catch, and you go to the pool. You don't need to do many moves. In three categories, what flair is. You've got walking flair. Walking flair is when you're behind the bar and you're using anything that is behind the bar, no matter how much alcohol you've got in your bottle. It doesn't matter. Okay, so you have to adapt. Okay? Then you've got exhibition flair. Exhibition flair is using, again, everything that belongs to the bar. Take the bottle in your right hand, okay, and the one behind you're watching, okay? And then you bring it to your left hand, catching it by the body. This is the neck, this is the body, this is the base. Okay? This is a straight grab, this is a reverse grab, this is a flat grab. From your left hand, from your right hand by the neck, you're going to bring it to your left hand by the body. In this position, you reverse your right hand, and then you bring it behind your head, outside your elbow, and then you bring it, you take it back with your left hand, that's right, and then you come back with a straight grab with your right hand, and then you get ready to pull. Thank you. Like, you're the one who said I was making a mess. Right? I don't want to make you lie. So, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, I'm going to pull. Yes?
Yes.
Great. 1, 2, 3, 4. No, up. Four and five. Okay? And then you stop. Now, one of the rules when you're flaring is like every move goes on the side. If my bar, if this was my front bar and this is my back bar, all the moves I'm going to do them on the side. Because if I drop, I will drop on the floor. Flare motion. Motion is the body of the movement. So for me, this is flare. Motion is how to use your legs. Okay? And how to rotate. So 1 and 2. You're holding it like this first. And you have to make sure it's in the middle of your hand.
Yeah.
And then you really have to throw it up like this. And you can catch like that. Then pull like this. Like this. And then you go on the side. And you come back. But I'm not that good at this one. Okay? To practice. And like this is the formula. Mm-hmm. Okay? The bottom goes going to fall that way. On the side, like this. And when it's like this, I pull my hand to do this. So, I go like this, and I'm going to go. But I do it with the body language, so I will go like this. Okay. Inside here. And then I will throw it like this, catch it. Like that. And like I told you, walking with style. So you go like this, up, you got it there. And pull inside here. Up. And then with style. Are you ready for the picture? Okay, 3, 2, 1.
Like being in the kitchen, it's like some...
Or being in the laboratory?
Well, a little bit, yeah, a little bit. It's you know which flavors work well together, and you try to create that in a drink. So you take whatever you have at your disposal in the bar.
How long is your train to be the champion like you?
I think we've all been at it for more than 10 years. Nicholas about 14, Arno 12, and I'm 11 almost.
But we're learning every day.
So you learn something new.
Some advice to everybody who wants to be the champion like you.
Work hard, practice.
Yeah.
Keep working at it and keep thinking of how you can better yourself every day. And get to your ball, look how it is. Try to find the best way to work and keep working at your art, whether it's...
Thank you very much and have a nice day in Poland.
Yes,
okay. Thank you very much.
So we are a team of specialists, so to say, special forces, and we want to educate and share the bartenders with our knowledge and experience. And it's to me to open this seminar. I will tell you something about techniques, distillation, and so on. And this little guy is the heart of our process. It's a Jindian small pot still. I will explain you shortly. This is still working, and we used it in former days to make some trials on laboratory scale and upscale it when we have a good product, tasting and retrying, tasting, upscaling on the big pot still. But this is still the heart of our profession. Most is actually the oldest distiller in Europe, I think. But the Kuiper is the oldest family distiller. If we look at the 17th and 18th century, Geneva was very, very popular. We exported, the Dutch industry, exported all over the world. And then it went down. Because the English adopted this product and transformed to gin, well known. Okay. That's the reason we never use cane, sugar, alcohol. It can develop a rum character in the end. And so we are using now in Holland neutral spirit from grain. There are two factories in the world, most modern factories.
I'm Matthijs Janssen, I'm the master distiller of the Kuiper Royal Distillers. I'm working 35 years with this company. And they call me the brain because I'm a member of the A-team as well. And they ask me why. Well, if you work 35 years, you know everything about recipes, quality and all the details. And we're developing the liqueurs, spirits for the Kuiper. And we have broad experience, of course. And the most important issue is quality. If you have no quality, you will have no good product. And that's the main subject of our distilling practice. We have to keep our quality on a high, high level.
Very small, where you can buy everything you want to make drinks at home. So this is a picture of the place. You probably cannot see the picture. It looks amazing. Everything. I shortened it up a bit. If you have any questions, I'm going to be here all night, all day. I hope you had a good time, and see you later on with Nicholas doing the flair. So thank you.
Where's the camera? Because I cannot see.
Hi, my name is Arno, aka The Fixer. I'm part of the A-team from the Kuiper, from the Netherlands. My specialty in the A-team is fixing up good drink. Talking about ingredients and what works and what doesn't work in the bar. I think that the A-team in general is a group of specialists that tries to help out bartenders in different countries all around the world. Hey ladies, with special ingredients that I bring from the Netherlands, I can make up amazing drinks and worth serving in your bar. So, see you soon.
My name is Gio Carosalia, Mr. C for short. I work for the Kuiper, and my area of expertise is the bar, the hardware, and everything that happens, you know, behind it besides the mixology and the flair. So the basics, that's what I'm good at. I've been working as a bartender for the past 12 years, different types of bar, from huge clubs to just small little cocktail bars that only can serve 10 people at the same time. Only 10 people can sit inside at the same time. And what that has given me is a knowledge of how to take care of your bar, how to set up your bar, you know, just to how to put your tools, how to take care of your tools, clean it. And that's what I do. That's my area.
You had like the distillery training, you had like the mixology training with Arno, and I'm going to show you and talk to you about flair bartending, for those who care. Flair bartending basically is the art of making a drink while entertaining the bar, the customers at the same time, using everything that belongs to the bar. Bartending is not juggling, okay? Juggling comes from circus, okay? I'm not a clown. Yeah, I'm a clown, but I'm not a clown. You have to sense the difference. You know Tai Chi? You don't know? Here we go. So everything has to go on the side. You have three types of flair. You got working flair, exhibition flair, and flair art. Flair art is new to the industry. And it's something that you will see more and more.
Hi guys, my name is Nicolas Saint-Jean. I'm from France. I've been a flair bartender for the past 14 years. And yeah, basically I've worked really hard to get to where I am now. Practice sometimes 14 hours a day. I know it sounds very difficult to believe, but yes. Sometimes even non-stop, even when I'm sleeping, I was just dreaming and I will see my routines and my moves coming together. It doesn't come like that. You really need to put a lot of time and dedication to make it look very easy. But I never copy anybody. I always wanted to stay myself and be original. And this is what I try to teach now in my school with Flair Motion, which is now in France. And here today in Poland, with the Kuiper A team, this is what we're trying to do. We all specialize in different area, and me as a flair bartender, I'm just trying to share my knowledge and my experience for all the young bartenders that want to learn how to do the same, how to be themselves with no copy.